Yo, what's up, bitches? It's the Duster and Christopher. What's good? All right, we're here to review movies now. It's the quarter four. I saw well over 100 movies now. I should have done this video like a year and a half ago. First off, we're doing Widows, directed by Steve McQueen, and it stars Viola Davis, Elizabeth Debicki, Liam Neeson, Daniel Kaluuya, Michelle Rodriguez, who I really want to
Carrie
fuck,
Coon,
Carrie Coon,
Brian Tyree Henry,
Cynthia Erivo,
Colin Farrell, fucking
Robert Duracest Vaughn.
Morgan Freeman.
He's not in this.
You're a liar. He is.
No, I'm not. You're not. He's not in this movie, people.
He played Daniel Kaluuya's brother.
Morgan Freeman is not God.
Stop trying to be God.
Shut up. Nah, man. This movie was fucking disappointing as shit.
I really liked it, but it's disappointing. But I really liked it.
No one cares. Here's the thing.
Suck my dick.
No, I'm not gonna do that,
You
Chris.
got
No, I don't. I don't wanna suck Chris's dick.
I think like for a Steve McQueen movie, and I'm saying this because I think like his movies prior to this are all fucking masterpieces. This is just a really step down in terms of like writing, and I don't think this movie has like the subtlety or like the just any of the nuance that you find in those movies. But I think the performances and just the story and some of McQueen's directing really elevate the fuck out of this. It underwhelmed me, but I think it's worth seeing just specifically for the performances from Kaluuya and Elizabeth Debicki.
Daniel Kaluuya is awesome in this movie. He's in it for literally 7 minutes, and by the time he gets axed off in this movie, it's the most insulting thing in the world. And he disappears for like 45 minutes, and then they underuse everyone. The plot doesn't make any sense. It's overbloated. By the time they get backstory to Viola Davis and Liam Neeson's characters, stop. You goofy fuck. You find out Viola Davis and Liam Neeson had a son who got shot by the cops wrongfully, and Liam Neeson therefore wants to fucking fake his own death, have a baby with a white woman. Stop it, you fuck. This is not the time for praise the Lord.
But it's Sunday!
We're not talking about First Reformed over here, you ass. It's offensive, all right? Because he wants to have a child with a white woman instead, so he knows that child wouldn't get shot by the cops. Subtext,
Cop
people.
shot the kid.
Shut the fuck up, Chris. No, don't fucking tongue people. This movie sucked. It's a 4 out of 10. Robert Duvall's terrible. Colin Farrell had a bad accent. Elizabeth Debicki's really good.
Low 8.5 out of 10 for me.
Lame. Next up is Bohemian Rhapsody, directed by Bryan Singer.
The Rapist.
Yeah.
it's not good.
Yeah, it's not. This really is like the definition of a highlight reel movie, and Rami Malek is phenomenal in it, but that's just because he's a really great actor. It's just the material is horrible and very rushed. 20 minutes in, Queen is already famous. It's not even what? It's like an hour into Straight Outta Compton until they're famous. Stupid. Inferior. Bohemian Rhapsody is inferior to Straight Outta Compton. The concert scenes are cool. It's impressive that Rami Malek lip-synced, all well and everything, and they made it look, believable. But, the Live Aid sequence, everyone's saying that's great, but you could just watch it on YouTube and it's even better. And a lot of it is just rushed. It's just a rushed movie. It sort of like makes it antagonizes his homosexuality at one point as like sort of a negative. And just it didn't feel like really like it felt like it was struggling to be either a Freddie Mercury biopic or a Queen biopic, and it really wasn't either of them that successfully. I thought it was very generic. Next. Boy, boy, boy.
It's a Wild Life.
Yeah, Wildlife, directed by Paul Dano. Woo! Yeah! Ho-ho! Stars Jake Gyllenhaal, Ed Oxenbold, and Carey Mulligan. And I just gotta say, this movie is depressing as fuck. It's a fucking movie about divorce and a disintegrating marriage. And Carey Mulligan, she doesn't spend that much time with her husband, played by Jake Gyllenhaal, and then she ends up fucking Bill Camp from The Night Of. And It's cringe, and Chris fucking adored this movie.
I thought this was fantastic. I really thought this was just like a beautiful, heartfelt movie. I think Paul Dano just really brought a lot of nuance and subtlety to it. I think like there's a lot of unlikable shit in it, but I think it's worth watching for the cinematography and a fucking outstanding Ed Oxenbold performance. So
I didn't like this movie.
It's a 9 out of 10 for me.
Ugh, Chris.
I'm sorry. But it is a wild life.
A lot of this movie is just monotonous bullshit, and Ed Oxenbold's performance is low-key, but to, like, a fault. I like dialogue, okay? And, like, I just felt like this movie, like, I felt he should have reacted stronger to certain moments, but not the actor, I mean the character. And I just thought it was just way too, like, sort of anticlimactic, and I just felt like it was just sort of like meandering, and it just sort of didn't have much of a point to it. The performances all across the board are really good, specifically Jake Gyllenhaal and Bill Camp. But this movie has like a really funny moment where Bill Camp just has like an elongated scene where he has a cigar and it just stays on him for 10 seconds, and I started bursting out laughing.
And he's staring at Carey Mulligan's ass while he's
smoking. Well, yeah, and the kid too, so that's kind of creepy.
He wants to fuck the kid.
He wants to fuck Ed Oxenbold in this movie.
The movie's a metaphor.
Then Alexander will have a really terrible, no good, very bad day. Yeah, this movie, I didn't like it. It was just fucking boring, and I could care less. I mean, it was period accurate. It was good in terms of, like, you know, performances and the cinematography and everything and the score sometimes. But I want Paul Dano to direct a movie that's just as good as his acting ability. Yay. Can you ever forgive me?
Probably not.
Well, I didn't do anything.
He didn't.
Fuck
He's
you.
A good person.
Yeah, fuck you, Chris. You bitch. All right. But Can You Ever Forgive Me is directed by Marielle Heller, and it stars Melissa McCarthy, Richard E. Grant, and Ben Falcone. This is another, like, who gives a fuck movie. Like, it's about Melissa McCarthy. She's a writer. It's based off a true story, like every other movie that comes out. And she's like a fucking plagiarist, and she starts, like, you know, writing letters and forging letters and about, like, you know, from famous authors, but they're not really from the famous authors. They're from her, because she's a fucking phony bitch, and she's fat, and she's Melissa McCarthy. No, in all seriousness, she's great in this movie, but, like, this, like, it's another, like, why is this getting Oscar attention? Just because how, like, uneventful this year is? It's, and Richard E. Grant's fine in it, but why is he getting supporting actor nomination, you know, buzz? He's not that good in this. He's really not. Chris, what do you have to say about this movie, goof?
I really like this movie. I think Melissa McCarthy is fucking amazing in it. And I genuinely am happy that she's getting, like, the awards attention she is. I really loved her last movie, Diary of a Teenage Girl. It's not as good as that movie, but I think it's still worth checking out. I really liked it. It's not one of the best movies of the year, but I enjoyed it for what it was. It's like a low 8, 8.5 out of 10 for me.
You hear that, folks? It's another split decision. And Can You Ever Forgive Us? No, because this movie is fucking boring.
I don't want your forgiveness.
The Mule, directed by Clint Eastwood. And I thought this movie was going to be great. It had a great trailer.
Me too.
It's, you know, it had Clint Eastwood, it had Bradley Cooper, Michael Peña, Clifton Collins Jr., Diane Wiest, an all-star cast, to say the least. That's right, Dustin Rhymes, and I'm here to feast on the motherfucking rot. No, I'm not doing this. The movie. It's about a fucking 90-year-old drug dealer and Clint Eastwood, the 88-year-old actor, director, writer, composer, producer. He's playing this guy. And it's, I remember when this story came out, and, yeah, this is crazy. He was the perfect choice. And he was great in the movie. I think he brought a lot of humor to it, and just a lot of levity and humanity to it. And you really believed what his character was going through, and you sympathized and empathized with him. But the movie was very generic, and it was just very, like, been there, done that at certain points. I felt like a lot of it was sort of pointless, how it was sort of trying to, like, split between it being, like, a movie about Clint Eastwood and a movie about, like, an FBI procedural with Bradley Cooper and Lawrence Fishburne and Michael Peña. I thought that was very distracting. And they underused the shit out of Bradley Cooper and Michael Peña. and they
especially
didn't
painful.
Yeah, and they really didn't have much of a point in this movie after a while. And they try to do like a heat scene in the diner in like a Waffle House in this movie with Bradley Cooper and Clint Eastwood, and it's just whatever. And there's some good performances in it. Diane Weiss, though, and Allison Eastwood in particular are both fucking Razzie worthy in this, especially Diane Weiss, who's like an incredible actress. And she's just god-awful. Like, near the end, she just has, like, a monologue where she's, like, dying. And all of her delivery is, like, the funniest thing I've ever seen.
I fucking hated this movie. It's, like, a low 4 to 10 for me. I think Clint Eastwood's really great in it. I think Bradley Cooper, you know, as always, is great in it. But they're working against a really shitty script and really just generic, boring characters. It's like a low 4 out of 10 for me. Sorry, Clint. Make a better movie. Fuck.
Yeah, you old fuck. You fucking trouble with the curve. Smag.
And that's why I don't drink. I'm like a bird. I only fly away.
I don't know where my soul is. What's up, everyone? Happy New Year's Eve. Dusty's here. Dusty's here. He's here to give you the best and worst movies of the year. Now, before I do that, I already gave you little mini reviews of some movies I wanted to talk about. There's a couple other movies I kind of wanted to talk about, but it's not even worth it. Go on my Letterboxd. The link is in the description. Go on my Letterboxd. You can read all my reviews. I update it all the time. It's very in-depth. I write long reviews. I have a lot on my mind. I have a lot of free time. However, I do want to talk about one movie before I jump into these lists. And it's Welcome to Marwen.
Welcome to Marwen is the most original film of the year.
Bullshit! Now, Welcome to Marwen is directed by Robert Zemeckis. It stars Steve Carell, Leslie Mann, Janelle Monáe, amongst others. And I'm speechless about this movie. I have no idea what this was. And the strangest part about it is that it's not even in my top 20 worst of the year, even though I hated it. I hated just the whole spirit of this movie. It was just a fake, incomprehensible mess.
I got beaten within an inch of my life because I was different.
Some Nazi thugs jumped him.
So I created a world where I can be anyone I want.
Yeah, so this is a true story, and apparently this happened in Ulster County, which is pretty close to me, which is kind of alarming. He was beaten by a bunch of white supremacists just for wearing high heels. That's what the marketing isn't telling you. He's not a cross-dresser. He just likes wearing women's shoes and collecting them. He's not gay. He's not even a transvestite. He just likes women's shoes. Good for him. Why kick the shit out of him for that? I mean, yeah, that's the point. But Steve Carell plays this guy, Mark Hogenkamp, and I just want to say this right off the bat. Steve Carell is way too good for this movie. He is giving his all for this movie, like he does for everything. Like I said, I've always said this. He turns everything he does into gold, his performance, at least, because it paints him as such, like, he's empathetic, of course, mostly because of the performance. But they don't really paint this guy in that complimentary of a light. He's kind of creepy. He's very creepy around women. And the whole movie, it's insinuated that he lives his fantasies through, like, a drug hallucination because he's addicted to his pills. Once you figure that out in the movie, it's like, yeah, I guess that's why the rest of this movie makes zero sense when it comes to the animation scenes, because, and that's a shame, too, because I just want to say the animation in this movie is probably Robert Zemeckis' best out of, like, all of his animation in the past, you know, from The Polar Express to A Christmas Carol. I think this movie, the animation looks great. I just had no idea what I was watching. All of the dialogue was just super dated and not interesting. Everyone was a stereotype in that world. Well, obviously, but just, there was nothing. And all the human characters, there was more screen time with the women of Marwen in the doll world than there was in the actual real world. I would have liked to have known, like, more about Janelle Monáe and Isaac Gonzalez's characters, you know? I love how the marketing just leaves out one woman who's in the Marwin universe. And I'm not talking about Diane Kruger's character, who I will get to in a second.
These are the women of Marwin.
Are all of the dolls people you know?
Yeah. There's Carlala.
You can't keep on running away.
Julie.
We got your back.
Roberta.
Back off!
And Nicole.
I'm talking about this cheap gag in the movie, how one of the women in Marwin is a porn star. And not only a porn star, Mark's favorite porn star. And that's another thing that's weird. How do all of these dolls just magically look like all, like everyone in this movie? How does he get dolls that look like him and everyone he knows? I know that has to not be real in the real life story. Like, he doesn't have, like, real looking people dolls, does he? Is that guy really a creep? Yeah, and the fact that the movie has me debating that is kind of sad. I don't want to feel, like, you know, sort of weird towards this guy because I feel bad for him. I don't think he deserved what he got, obviously. And Steve Carell is great in the movie, but other than that, this movie is super confusing and it's super manipulative. They use his drug addiction as a way to use Diane Kruger's character, who's like a Nazi witch blue fairy or whatever, and she's like a metaphor for his pill addiction. She's really the one, she represents the pills. What the fuck? This is the guy who did Forrest Gump and Back to the Future?
From the groundbreaking director of Forrest Gump.
Don't just imagine yourself as a hero. Be one in real life.
How is he in any way a hero in real life? What the fuck is this movie? It's mind-boggling, you know? And I know Robert Zemeckis hasn't made a movie of that level in a very long time, but, you know, he's made at least an effort. Like, I really liked Flight with Denzel Washington, which he actually directed, and A Christmas Carol I liked, and I really like The Polar Express. This movie just made me feel horrible inside. Everything was just so manipulative. The performances in this movie are okay, but it was mostly Steve Carell's movie. I really liked Leslie Mann in this movie, which is kind of ironic because I don't really like her in many other things at all, but she was actually okay in this, and so was Merritt Weaver from Nurse Jackie. I thought she was actually one of the better parts of the movie. But they give nothing to these characters, and but it has one of the biggest, like, head-scratching third acts I've seen this entire decade. Robert Zemeckis just puts in this fucking, like, Back to the Future reference out of nowhere. I'm not even kidding. Look, it's them in a time machine, him and the dumb blue bitch fairy. I feel so bad for Diane Kruger in this movie, how she had to play that character in this movie. It just the way those scenes were directed were just insane to me. Just the way they would just have her deliver certain lines. I don't even blame her. Another thing that bothered me about this movie is that the white supremacist characters in this movie, they cut back to that brutal beating like 3 or 4 times in this movie. And there is those characters, I'm not saying humanize those characters, but give me a little more screen time with the actual white supremacists. You know, let me see if they even want to make a change with their lives. Do they even regret what they did? Nothing. They cheaply use this guy, this creepy fucking Nazi, as a jump scare in one of the scenes, and I just thought it was laughable. It's just an insult, this movie, completely. It's so funny how this movie wants to be like a Forrest Gump-level Oscar bait movie, but I was thinking about Small Soldiers, that fucking Tommy Lee Jones movie from the 90s. Robert Zemeckis, not only did he make one of the most ambitiously disappointing films of this year, he just, it didn't even seem like he cared about the real story. He just wanted to do his crazy animation, you know, and just cheap comedy. That's another thing. All the trailers are, like, highlighting this moment.
More ammo! More ammo!
I thought I heard you yelling for more gumbo.
Not gumbo! No gumbo!
And this movie is not a comedy at all. And that moment in particular in the movie, within the context of the movie, it's not even funny. Like, it's kind of disturbing. Like, he's having, like, PTSD and a drug trip out all simultaneously, and Steve Carell is giving a good performance, but this movie is treating it like a joke, like everything else. By the end of this movie, it becomes so cynical to a morbid degree where it's like, yeah, this guy, yeah, he's probably gonna die alone and have no love life, you know, whatsoever, but at least he has his dolls and his art installation. That's fucking bleak. I'm surprised there wasn't a scene in this movie where, like, Steve Carell opens a box of chocolates and there's, like, no chocolates in it. Fuck this movie.
To life, to love, to Marwin.
Welcome to Marwin.
All right. I don't want this video to be 3.5 hours long, so let's just run down the top 20 worst movies of this god-awful, forsaken, butthole fucking year. What, is there a siren going on now? Woo! Worst of the year! Woo! The ambulance knew! The ambulance knew it was up! Woo! 20 is Night School. And while I am a fan of Kevin Hart and Tiffany Haddish, I love Kevin Hart's stand-up, and I'm really upset that he is not hosting the Oscars. That's a whole nother video. It was a cheap comedy. I'm kind of surprised Nicholas Stoller, like, co-wrote this movie, because he's better than this. It was mean-spirited to the 10th degree. It didn't know how to use its supporting cast, its talented supporting cast that included Rob Riggle and Al Madrigal and Romney Malco, who got the few laughs out of me in this film. At the end, I didn't laugh very much, and it just didn't make me feel very good. And to me, it's probably Kevin Hart's weakest film. Next up is a Netflix original film, Set It Up, which I talked about in one of my recap videos. And yeah, this is a movie that surprisingly got great reviews, and the people are saying, oh, it reinvents the romantic comedy mold, even though it doesn't betray the romantic comedy mold whatsoever. Yeah, this movie is, like, insanely cliched, super predictable, insanely cynical, and I love Zoe Deutsch, but she had no chemistry with Glenn Powell, who was a total D-bag in this movie, and it was just super smarmy, and I thought it was more so the performance than the character. I just didn't like the performance, and I couldn't take him seriously that entire movie because of that dumb fuck haircut he had. However, I do give this movie 1 point for having Pete Davidson as the gay best friend. And he was really great in this movie. Too bad he's in it for 5 minutes. Next up, it's Midnight Sun by 2018's newest auteur, Scott Speer, starring...
Bitch, I'm Bella Thorne, bitch, I'm Bella Thorne. Bitch, I'm Bella Thorne, bitch, I'm Bella Thorne.
The Queen. That's all I really gotta say, right? I mean, I don't want to talk about this movie. Next up, number 17, another Netflix movie, Mute, directed by a good director, Duncan Jones. And this was a colossal failure, disappointment, and it features one of Paul Rudd's best performances. Yeah, I might relate a little bit to Paul Rudd in this movie, but still, this movie was dumb. It followed the wrong main character, and I didn't care about anything that happened, and it was derivative of 50 other movies. And number 16, another Netflix movie, Game Over Man. I did not want this to be one of my worst movies of the year, but it is, just on the sole fact that I was disappointed that the Workaholics guys couldn't make an actually funny comedy. I really loved the first two seasons of Workaholics, and like I've said, it peaked after that. But Adam Devine really bogs this movie down. He's horrendous in this, as usual, and the other two guys are trying, but this movie goes for the lowest common denominator of gross-out gags, and it was just oddly, oddly bad. Next up, the most forgettable movie of this year, Insidious, The Last Key. I didn't see the other two Insidious movies. I saw the first one, and I love that, but this movie was just a waste of my time and a waste of my date. I had a date, and it was boring. All right, coming up to number 14, which I will talk a little bit about. NIFA-nominated director James Wan has officially said, fuck that horror shit, yo. I'm going for that action shit. That cash, cash money, baby!
That cash, cash money, baby!
James Wan, for one thing, knew he was directing an Aquaman movie. That's for sure. He put his own style to it. He was probably having a lot of fun when he made this movie. Probably everyone was. You know, I don't think this movie went through as many reshoots as Justice League or Solo, a Star Wars story, you know? This movie is fucking stupid. Even though the story is easy to comprehend, it's just not interesting. Patrick Wilson is basically Loki in this movie, and Patrick Wilson is a villain again. He's a villain. Why? It didn't work in the A-Team. Why is he a villain this time? He's playing his half brother, Aquaman's half brother, and Aquaman is Jason Bromoa at his finest, looking all hunky for the ladies. Fuck that guy, honestly. He can't act. He's decent at best. No, he sucks. I don't like him. Amber Heard's actually trying. Nicole Kidman's trying, even though she has horrible material to work with. The visuals in this movie are all over the place. Some of them are okay, and then by the last third, it's like incomprehensible and just a mess to look at. Very comparable to the Fantastic Four third act. The acting's bad. The score is bad. The script is horrendous. The dialogue is horrendous. The villains, like Black Manta is awful in this movie, played by the fucking cop from Baywatch. What? What is that casting? I know that movie was also, you know, set around water, but, like, what is this guy, like, a water movie fanatic? I mean, I'm not gonna pretend that I was ever excited for Aquaman to begin with, but still. Like, everyone always thought Aquaman was a joke, and he's still a joke, alright? Even though you replace the good, clean-cut, blonde-haired, white-eyed, you know, an Aryan version of Aquaman that we grew up looking at, and you replace him with People Magazine's sexiest Aquaman, you know? And he's just a roided out, he's an alcoholic asshole in this movie, first of all, and he's just an idiot. He has juvenile humor. This is, I can't believe this movie wasn't made in 1997. I'm really surprised that they actually made this movie, especially since Entourage made it so clear how dumb this idea was to begin with. Next up is Status Update. Scott Speer masterpiece, obviously. Next up is River Runs Red. It stars Taye Diggs, John Cusack, and George Lopez. And George Lopez gives the best performance in this movie. We're living in an alternate dimension. Coming in at number 11, missing right out of my top 10, is The Happy Time Murders, one of the laziest and shortest comedies I've seen in a very long time, and it takes such a semi-promising premise and does nothing with it. And Melissa McCarthy could have been any actress in this movie. Anybody could have played that part. And the main puppeteer guy, Bill Beretta, is good, but the whole movie, he's just saying Horatio Caine dialogue. All right, moving into the top 10. Top 10 time. We got Netflix original, The After Party, one of the most mean-spirited and just plain unfunny comedies of the year. It stars Kyle, the rapper. Fuck this movie. I hated it. Number 9 is the most enjoyable bad movie of the year, Gotti. Gets the Aloha Award for best what-the-fuck movie of the year. Yep, eat your heart out, Welcome to Marwin. Kevin Connolly directed such a mess that I couldn't even feel bad for him, because you know that the Gotti family was manipulating him the entire time. And Travolta's giving it his all. It's just, he's giving it his all with really shit material. And Kelly Preston is awful in this movie. And Spencer Lofranco looks way too young for this role. And the entire movie is a mess. That it's so messy that it's hysterical. And I can't even hate it. I acknowledge it's horrible. That's why it's on this list. It's a horrible movie, though. It's so factually incorrect, and it paints him as like a saint. It's really despicable, this movie, but I kind of just love destroying it. Number 8, possibly the most lazy movie of the year, comedy-wise, is Action Point, starring Johnny Knoxville, which I ranted about this movie enough in my review. You can go back and watch that. But it was just a lazy 80s throwback comedy with zero jokes and just a horrible premise. Coming in at number 7 is a movie no one probably saw, Little Italy. It's this movie I watched when I was stoned. It's a romantic comedy with Hayden Christensen and Emma Roberts, and they're like rival pizza chefs, and it's like Romeo and Juliet, but modern day, and it's set in Canada, by the way. I thought it was set in New York when I saw the trailer, but no, it's set in Canada, and everyone is an Italian stereotype in this movie. How does that work? This movie is kind of interesting how much it follows like every mark on the checklist for romantic comedy cliches. Like, this movie has all of them. It's sort of like revolutionary how bad the cliches are used in this movie. The biggest sin of this movie is that the pizza looked like shit. Number six, it's another Netflix movie, and while probably not the worst Netflix movie of the year, it's definitely the most overrated, Bird Box. I fucking hated Bird Box. It's so dumb. First of all, if you make a movie that makes me question whether or not The Happening was actually a masterpiece, then you did something wrong, okay? This movie is literally The Happening, but worse. I know they wrote the movie's based off a book that was written before The Happening, but even the author, the way the author describes that book, they had no idea what they were writing. The monsters in this movie are non-existent. You don't see anything. All you see is Sandra Bullock and these dumbass kids and everyone else in this movie just stumble around with blindfolds on, and it's unintentionally hilarious with no self-awareness whatsoever of how goofy this premise is. At least The Happening had some self-awareness to it, had some funny tongue-in-cheek dialogue, as much as you want to make fun of that movie, but it makes me take that movie seriously. What? No, you must be going, but I'm going, what? Yes! Alright, that was corny. Whatever. This whole movie was corny. Fuck you people. You're corny for liking this movie. Fuck the Twitter following for this movie. We're all fucking fucked, as MGK said. Number five is Father of the Year, Netflix original. Horrible comedy, really forgettable, terrible characters, mean-spirited as fuck, horrible gross-out gags, terrible performances. David Spade, you could do better than this. Number four, I have The Package, which is another really juvenile, horrible, completely unfunny movie. Horrible performances, terribly mean-spirited as well. Super cliched. It tries to be so many different types of teen coming-of-age comedies, and it has no idea what tone it wants to be. And it's just gross for the sake of being gross, and it's produced by the Workaholics guys. And Ben Stiller, for some reason. Number three, another Netflix movie. Dude, starring four women. And Lucy Hale is the lead. She plays a grieving, girlfriend of, you know, a guy that died. And she's depressed with her three best friends. And it's supposed to be a stoner girl comedy, but it never finds its tone very well. It's from the writer of Ocean's 8. And while I didn't hate Ocean's 8 at all, it wasn't really anything special. But this movie was just really cloyingly melodramatic, and Lucy Hale is just a horrible lead actress. Number two, another Netflix movie, When We First Met, starring Adam Devine as a guy who is so alone and so desperate, and he's an alcoholic, and he goes back in time and tries to marry Alexander Daddario, but halfway through the movie, he realizes that he wouldn't be happy with Alexander Daddario because she doesn't really love him for who he is, and then yeah, it's one of those movies, and people like this movie online, and I do not, and it's charmless. It's super predictable, horrible acting. Adam Devine is a charmless lead. He is a cancer. And the worst movie of the year, Big Shock, Truth or Dare. As soon as I saw it, I didn't think I was going to see a movie that frustrated me more, and I was right. It's from the director of Kick-Ass 2, which I actually really enjoyed, but what the fuck happened to this director? He made one of the most mean-spirited, if not the most mean-spirited horror film of the decade. And the way this movie ends is so horrible. And you don't care about any of these characters. Lucy Hale, again, don't let her lead your movie. She is horrible in this movie. She is so over the top and so whiny, and I don't understand why she's a lead actress in anything. And none of these people in this movie are good except the Asian kid. And what they do with the Asian kid, how they kill him off in the movie, is an insanely insulting moment in this film. He's the only character you care about, and then the way they kill him off is just like, Jesus. This was like a more mean-spirited version of the Final Destination movies, but with absolutely no logic to it.
Okay, I was gone for a minute, but I'm back now.
I'm done talking about the worst movies of the year.
So we're gonna do this thing, or what? I mean, is this happening?
I believe we can make this work.
Hot damn.
All right. starting off the top 20 with a bang. A bang bang. We got Vice, directed by Adam McKay. This was my most anticipated film for the rest of the year, people. And 2018 at it again. Yeah, I really like the movie. Okay, I do. I mean, the performances all across the board. I mean, you've probably heard it from your Chris Stuckmans or your Christian Harloffs or your Mark Ellis's or your Grace Randolphs or your or whatever the fuck bullshit you watch.
I have like a million subscribers.
These people are all incredible in it. Christian Bale, while it's not my favorite Christian Bale performance like I thought it would be, he's amazing in it. And he deserves a nomination at the very least. And it's one of his best performances, that's for sure. He nails every single nuance of Dick Cheney. Amy Adams is just as good as Christian Bale in this movie. Amy Adams is great. And they're once again, they're just a great on-screen team. Sam Rockwell, amazing as George W. Bush, even though he wasn't in the movie very much. And even Steve Carell as Donald Rumsfeld. Great. That's not my problem with the movie. My problem with the movie is its tone. And I feel like this movie could have been a straight drama. I don't feel like it needed all of those forced comedic moments in it. And if you see the movie, you know what I mean. Especially the post-credits scene, which is downright obnoxious. To me, elements like those in this film and pointless cameos from people like Alfred Molina, I don't fuck with. And I don't think this movie is even in the same conversation as The Big Short in terms of quality. However, I do think it's one of the best films of this year because this year is fucking horseshit. It's still a really good movie. It's well made. Everyone in the movie's good. Tyler Perry shows up as Colin Powell. He's terrific. Vice is my number 20 of the year. A small independent film from earlier this year comes in my number 19 spot. It's a directorial debut. Talking about Corey Finley's Thoroughbred, starring Olivia Cooke and Anya Taylor-Joy alongside Anton Yelchin in his final on-screen role. Now, if you didn't see this movie, do. It's a great twisty-turny little independent crime comedy. It's pitch-black dark comedy. It's pretty hilarious in certain moments, and it bolsters the best performance of Olivia Cooke and Anya Taylor-Joy's careers. And Anton Yelchin, I mean, it's devastating that he's not going to be in another movie again. And I think he was taken away way too soon. He was a hell of an actor. He gives an incredible final performance in this movie. Go into it not knowing that much. It's a delightful surprise, and it stuck with me the whole year.
Things out there, I mean, wonderful things that are worth living for. I mean, you got soup, and, you know, that first... You know, when, oh God, I can only think of soup. Anybody? Somebody? Patty?
Salad.
Salad.
How in the hell did Paul Feig direct one of my favorite movies of the year? Simple Favor. It stars Anna Kendrick and Blake Lively, yada, yada. This was like a dark comedy, right? This was like the synopsis for a year online before any trailers came out. It was like, Paul Feig is going to make a thriller. From the dark side of Paul Feig. And then you see the trailer and it's like, is this going to be okay? And then you see the movie and it's really good. It's really sharply written. Co-written by Paul Feig. Excellent performances throughout. Anna Kendrick gives the best performance of her career since Up in the Air. Blake Lively gives the best performance of her career, period. I've always loved her, but she really, really, really deserved Oscar buzz for this. And yeah, this is another movie. Don't go into it knowing that much. It's just a delight. It's just one of the pleasant surprises of this year, and I thoroughly had a great time. Coming in at number 17 is Blindspotting, another really solid directorial debut. It stars Daveed Diggs and Rafael Casal. It's another movie I reviewed. It's a great dramatic, comedic drama, I would say, with a lot of great comedic moments. It has one of the greatest scenes of the year involving Mr. Sawed-Off Leatherface. It has a great message, terrific performances from Rafael Casal and especially Daveed Diggs, who I expect a lot from in the future. Just a really solid movie. Coming in at number 16 is American Animals, directed by Bart Layton and starring Evan Peters, Barry Keoghan, Jared Abramson, and Blake Jenner. And yeah, this is a movie from the beginning of the year I thought it was going to end up in my top 10 of the year. And it was this close for me, this movie, for being great. But couple flaws aside, I still think this is a really original heist movie with really interesting and unique characters and a really interesting narrative structure. Evan Peters is a goddamn star. He's amazing in this movie and deserved so much more awards attention for this performance. He's so layered and cool, and just, I can't wait to see what he does next in the future as well. Loved him. And Barry Keoghan is great. I love Barry Keoghan as well. Can't wait to see what he does next as well. 15 is Tag, and I don't give a fuck. I had really fun with this movie. It's really rewatchable, really quotable. Jake Johnson, John Hamm, Hannibal Buress, Ed Helms, Jeremy Renner, all of them are really, really good together, and they have terrific chemistry. For a directorial debut studio comedy, it's very frenetically edited, and the pacing's great, and it has an amazing soundtrack, too. Really fun. I recommend Tag. Fuck you. Plus, any movie that has this line in it is just instantly one of the best movies of the year.
Look, I'm not saying I want you to have a miscarriage.
Then don't.
Because that would be terrible. But if you ever do have a miscarriage, I don't want to say that you would deserve it, because that's too far. But what I will say, and what I do feel, is that's what you get.
How the fuck does Jake Johnson not have Oscar buzz for this? Next up is Beautiful Boy at number 14. I thought this was a great addiction drama. Steve Carell going to new heights once again. He's terrific in this film, playing Timothy Chalamet's grieving dad, who's trying to deal and cope with his son's addiction to meth and heroin. And Timothy Chalamet is absolutely amazing in this movie. He absolutely deserves the Oscar, in my opinion, this year. And if anybody else wins over him, that's kind of rubbed me the wrong way. I thought he channeled Matt Dillon in Drugstore Cowboy and Jared Leto in Requiem for a Dream. I would have liked a little bit more with the AA scenes, but
look at me, it's Timmy T.
Alright, no. I'm not doing this right now. I'm in a rush right now, Timothy, okay? No more statistics. If you do that one more time, I'm not talking about this movie anymore.
Statistics.
Yep. Alright, you took the chance. I'm not talking about it anymore. Fuck you, Timothy. I've had it with your goofy ass. Stop rapping about statistics and actually learn about them. Arizona. None of you saw this. Arizona. Coming in at number 12 is Fuck yeah. It's one of the most entertaining movies of the year. It's one of the funniest movies of the year. It's one of the most beautifully animated movies of the year. And it's hysterical. It's like, I really liked it. And it had the best Stan Lee cameo of the year. By the way, rest in peace, Stan Lee. Dusty got sentimental for a second, yo. Anyway, back to some gangster shit. Teen Titans go to the movies. Yeah, this shit was badass, yo. Fucking, it's certified fresh by the Rotten Tagatoes. Yeah. Coming in at the 11th spot, Deadpool. Bruh. Yeah. If I allowed this to be in my top 10, that would have been really embarrassing. I mean, I like it more than the first Deadpool, but even thinking about that, like, I didn't think 2016 was that great of a year either, but that didn't even make my top 20 that year, I don't think, Deadpool. And I really like Deadpool. This was better in every way. Ryan Reynolds is better, the action's better, the effects are better, the soundtrack's better. It has a Little Pump original song, for Christ's sake. What more do you want? I get it. It's not everyone's cup of tea. I got it. I like it, though. Coming in at number 10 is Hereditary, directed by Ari Aster, and another directorial debut. It's one of the best horror films of the decade. I thoroughly enjoyed this. It has one of my favorite endings of the year. Toni Collette and Alex Wolff are both terrific in the movie. Everyone's great in this movie. Gabriel Byrne is very good. Millie Shapiro is very good. Ann Dowd is good. My biggest problem with this movie is that apparently there was like a longer cut of this movie, and I've seen the deleted scenes, and he cut out so many juicy, emotionally captivating scenes. And I am just really asshurt about him cutting them out of the movie. So, you're at the 10th spot, Hereditary. Destroyer, more like destroy, yeah. Yeah, this movie kicked ass. This was such a Dusty movie for me. Like, A Dusty movie is like a crime movie with a lot of awesome elements to it. Badass dialogue, badass characters, just badass badassness, like, everywhere. Karen Kusama directed this movie, the director of Jennifer's Body. Another 2018 what the fuck moment. She brilliantly directed this. It looks amazing. Some of the best cinematography of the year. Great musical score. Nicole Kidman gives probably the second best performance of her career behind To Die For, in my opinion. That's another movie you should check out. And another movie where Gus Van Sant remembered how to be a director. Anyway, this has a great ensemble cast. Bradley Whitford steals his scene in this movie, let me tell you. And it's just fucking dope. This is another twisty, turny little movie, and I dug almost every second of it. I really, slight pacing issues aside, this is right up my alley, and it did not disappoint. Number 8 is Alex Garland's Annihilation, starring Natalie Portman, Jennifer Jason Leigh, and Tessa Thompson, and Gina Rodriguez. And this was just a refreshing sci-fi thriller. Amazing visual effects, amazing cinematography, an incredible musical score by Jeff Barrow and Ben Salisbury. Hypnotic music for this film. Alex Garland proves once again that he can really tell a captivating sci-fi story with not overflowing amounts of, like, sci-fi in your face. He adds so much subtlety to not only this, but his previous film, Ex Machina, which, honestly, I think I like Annihilation more. The more I think about it, and Natalie Portman's performance is so magnetic and great and powerful, and it has one of the best third act scenes of the entire year, and it's so goddamn creepy. It's one of the best films of the year, Annihilation. Absolutely. At number 7 is The House That Jack Built, Lars von Trier's newest film, and I've seen his last two films only, and I'm not a huge von Trier fan, but I haven't disliked any of his films yet, and this was definitely up my alley. It is a character study about a serial killer played by Matt Dillon, of all people, and of course, Matt Dillon gives the best performance of the year. Only 2018. He's brilliant. He's brilliant in this movie. He's fucking hilarious. He's scary. He's menacing. He's all the qualities you need in a serial killer character like this. And von Trier isn't ever, like, making you empathize or sympathize with this character. It's just a dead-on portrayal of a serial killer. And it needs to be this unflinching. People have been complaining about how violent and gory it is. And, yeah, it takes some liberties. And I have a couple minor issues with the movie, not involving violence, but other things. But this movie is still really, really effective and really entertaining to me. And the dialogue is superb. Matt Dillon is amazing, like I said, and everyone else in the movie fits their role terrifically, especially Bruno Ganz as the co-starring role in this film as Verge. He's from Unknown, that Liam Neeson movie. What? Coming in at number 6 is A Star Is Born, directed by Bradley Cooper, the man. Another directorial debut this year. And it's another directorial debut that doesn't feel like one because of how masterfully done it is. It's amazing, this movie. I don't think it's one of the very best movies of the decade, like some people are proclaiming. But as far as musical dramas go, it's one of the very best I think I've ever seen. As far as, like, pure drama goes, this movie nails it. Lady Gaga is outstanding in this movie. Bradley Cooper gives one of the greatest performances of his career in this, completely disappearing into the role of Jackson Maine. It takes a lot to change a man, and it takes a lot to change. I love Bradley Cooper in this movie, and he has, like, that song he does in the beginning of the movie, Black Eyes, is one of the best rock songs of the decade. Not even kidding. Why the fuck is that not getting an Oscar campaign, that song? He does a fucking guitar solo and everything. He shreds it. I love Bradley Cooper. Sam Elliott, also amazing. He's not in the movie a whole lot, but I still think he deserves all the accolades he's been getting. He's kind of the heart of this movie, if you think about it. He's really heartbreaking in this movie. I loved him. Even if I wasn't crazy about all the songs, I don't think that was the point of the movie. And I think it was just an examination of this deteriorating relationship that blossomed out of something pure and beautiful. And it's just a beautifully told, albeit very depressing movie, but it's one of the most memorable films and entertaining ones of the year. There's a scene in this movie that, to me, rivals any scene in like an action thriller involving like the Grammys. And Bradley Cooper is performing at the Grammys, and you think he's gonna like fall over when he's performing, and he holds on to a note. It's like so fucking edge of your seat tense. I don't understand this year. Coming in at number 5 is Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse, yay! Directed by 3 people that I didn't remember their names. I apologize, fuck. I'm usually good about that. One of the guys directed Rise of the Guardians, this animated movie I didn't see from like 6 years ago. And it's co-written by Phil Lord, at least. And Chris Miller is also, you know, a part of it. It has an all-star cast, this movie. Shameik Moore from Dope, Jake Johnson, Liev Schreiber, Nicolas Cage, Mahershala Ali, Brian Tyler, Tyree Henry, Haley Steinfeld, John Mulaney, one of my favorite stand-ups. And the animation style is ridiculous and just one of the most beautiful I've seen, I think. And people have been complaining at the theater I work at about, like, is this supposed to be in 3D? You know, in the 2D showings, people are, like, losing their minds. The action and the visual style in this movie is breathtaking. And it never gets incomprehensible to me. It always fits its style perfectly. And the humor, of course, Phil Lord and Chris Miller, they know how to make a funny fucking movie. And they know how to not, you know, make movies just for kids. They can make movies for adults and kids to enjoy, and that's what makes a movie timeless. This movie will definitely be considered timeless. Everyone in the voice cast is great. The story is really good. I don't really have much to say that no one else has said about it, but I really loved it. Count me in as one of the lovers of this movie. All right, coming in at number 4 is Thunder Road, directed and starring Jim Cummings. It's a directorial debut. All right, you have no idea what I'm talking about. I have to show you a trailer for this.
Yeah, it's fine. I don't care. It's fine. I won't work here anyway. You want me to talk? Yeah, I'll talk. You don't want me to talk. I got dirt on all of y'all. I'll start with myself. My wife left me a year and a half ago. There, laugh it up.
This is going to be a hard one to describe. Jim Cummings plays a police officer, Officer Arnaud, and he just lost his mom. His mom died, and the movie starts out at him at her funeral. You remember that episode of BoJack Horseman when he's just at his mom's funeral eulogizing? Well, he starts dancing to Bruce Springsteen's Thunder Road, hence the title of the movie, and from that point of the movie, he kind of has a nervous breakdown. Now, this movie is a tragic comedy. From the clips I'm showing you, you're probably like, what? This has to be a drama. This looks really depressing. It's not. It's one of the goofiest fucking movies of the year, but in the best ways possible. It's so realistic, this movie. And Jim Cummings, directing, writing, acting, leading this movie, he is outstanding. Forget him being a director and a writer. Where the fuck has this guy been as an actor? This is the first I've ever seen him in anything, and he is jaw-droppingly brilliant in this movie. Like, I can't get over him.
I slept in my car! 3 weeks! Jerry saw it! Isn't that right, Jerry?
Yeah, I brought you breakfast.
Thank you so much for doing that, Jerry. That meant a lot back then.
Such an emotionally resonant and empathetic performance that he brings to the table. And you really do feel bad for this character the whole way through. You want him to, keep custody of his daughter because his wife is like a horrible person, deceptive drug addict. The movie is completely aware that you should be on his side, and everything good that ends up happening, good or bad, it's funny. And this movie establishes such an unique, realistic, real-to-life tone that I could never take it, you know, as a drama because of the events that were happening in this movie and how quirky they were. it's definitely a unique movie in that aspect. It some people could say this is a genreless movie, and this could be like one of the originators of like a future in genreless filmmaking. But I found it to be fucking hilarious, and it was emotionally resonant too. So I took the dramatic moments seriously, but I found it to be fucking hilarious and really poignant. And Jim Cummings is brilliant, and I cannot wait to see what he does next in any aspect of his career, whether it be an actor, writer, director. He's phenomenal.
This is what you get!
Okay.
Okay, so my top three movies of the year, they could all pretty much be interchangeable at this point. I know, that's anticlimactic. They're basically a tie. I usually don't believe in ties. It's not really a tie this year. I feel very similar to each three of these films, is that they're very close to being the best of the year. You guys wanted this. All right, three. Vox Lux, bitch!
From the public's perspective, this has been an emotional few years for you. Can you tell us what audiences can expect from the new album?
This is a culmination of my life's work so far. I was under a lot of stress after my accident, but that's what the show is about. It's about rebirth.
You're goddamn right, San Francisco Chronicle. Vox Lux, directed by Brady Corbett, is one of the best movies of the year. Like I said, it's directed by Brady Corbett, and it stars Natalie Portman, the Queen, my favorite person.
You shaved your head for V for Vendetta. Did you also shave your V for vagina?
Pass.
Raffi Cassidy, Stacey Martin from Nymphomaniac and Rosie, Jude Law, and just this movie is fucking great. Narrated by Willem Dafoe, the movie tells a story of Celeste, played by Raffi Cassidy and later played by Natalie Portman, a pop star in the making who rises to fame through tragedy. She gets famous for being like a victim of a school shooting, and she becomes a humongous pop star through that. Now, that's like the first 10 minutes of the movie, the school shooting aspect. And people have been complaining really bad, like really harshly about it, and saying, this is nonsense. This is nonsensical violence. No, it's just basically a shortened and better version of Gus Van Sant's Elephant. The way that jump starts the movie, it just caught my attention. And the style Brady Corbett brings to this is immaculate. The cinematography is some of the most gorgeous I've seen all year. Scott Walker's score is outstanding. There's a couple songs that Sia wrote for this movie that I thought were actually pretty damn good. Not all of the songs, you know, similar to A Star Is Born, are supposed to be, like, the best. I don't think that's the point of the movie. It's more of a character study. The songs, they fit the character, that's for sure. The writing is so sharp, the dialogue is realistic, and I thought it was very, very good. There's a lot of dark humor sprinkled throughout this that I thought was also very, very, very nice to see in a movie like this.
Celeste, come on. Everybody's downstairs.
All the people in this movie are very good. Like, Jude Law is, like, his voice is, like, unrecognizable in this. He's phenomenal. Showing a lot more range and versatility as an actor, as per usual. Raffi Cassidy is outstanding in this movie, playing a young version of Celeste and her daughter in the future. Stacey Martin is also terrific as Natalie Portman's sister in the film. All you guys have been hearing about this movie is Natalie Portman. I mean, it is the best performance of her career.
Mom, I'm worried about you.
You're worried about me?
All that matters is that you have an angle.
I'm scared.
It might very well be. I fucking adore Natalie Portman in like almost everything she's in, especially from this decade, but she's amazing in this movie, adding so much depth to a potentially unlikable character. There were so many inspirations, I think, that were drawn for this character. Not even Sia, but there's people like Britney Spears that come to mind, Amy Winehouse, you know, even Kanye West was one of the people they were thinking about while writing this movie. Cyndi Lauper came to mind. Like, so many different people. Tiffany. And it's just an amalgam of different superstars that she's sort of emulating. And it's just a brilliant performance.
It's a weird world we live in. And the way I've chosen to live my life.
Please don't follow me.
Goes against some people's views on things.
Do you mind if I get a quick picture with you?
I just thought this movie was fucking great. It's just a well-done, masterfully done movie. It was shot in like 20 days. And I don't know how you shoot a movie like this in 20 days. It's just fucking great. And like, the message is there. It's not pretentious to me. I'm not one of the people to find it pretentious. It's just phenomenal. I love this movie, and I can't wait to see what Brady Corbett does next as a director. He was an amazing up-and-coming actor back in the day with movies like Mysterious Skin, Funny Games. He was good in Funny Games. So, yeah, Brady Corbett. Fuck yeah.
Wanted a show. I gave him a show.
Looking to roll the dice and see a movie this week? Here's a clue. Don't risk seeing Game Night or you'll be sorry.
I can't believe you're still around. Yeah, so number two is Game Night. Easily the best comedy of the year. Now, I know originally in my tag review I said that movie's funnier, but this is just a better movie. I rewatched it again. This is a better movie. It's funnier. I'm sorry about that. John Francis Daly and Jonathan Goldstein are fucking great. They know how to write a great dark comedy. I thought the reboot of Vacation was a really decent dark comedy, and I thought Horrible Bosses, the first one, is one of the best comedies of this decade. Game Night joins those ranks. It has an amazing ensemble cast, one of the best of the year, with Jason Bateman, Rachel McAdams, Billy Magnussen, Lamorne Morris, Kylie Bunbury, my boy Kyle Chandler, and scene stealer Jesse Plemons, who honestly does deserve Oscar buzz. The editing is fantastic. The score by Cliff Martinez is one of his best of all time and one of the best scores of the year. The script is sharp and unpredictable, and the fact that like the movie kind of does go crazy near the end, and I wasn't bothered by that because the writing for it kind of did make sense to me. It's kind of a miracle. Just a really underrated and overlooked film that I'm surprised didn't get as much like Golden Globes or Critics' Choice nominations. It has some of the best lines of the entire year.
Time!
It was the Green Mile.
What? How is that the Green Mile?
This is me at the Regal Cinema crying as I did through much of the film.
How are we supposed to know that, Gary?
I assume everyone cried during the Green Mile.
Jesus Christ! What's with that knife?
It's for the cheese.
Man, glass tables are acting weird tonight.
These are the elite, the very best.
White people! Whoa.
Hell yeah, Game Night. It's one of the best dark comedies of the decade. Yeah, mid-90s is number one. I know it seems like a cop-out because that was my whole last video was about that movie, but yeah, I that's how lame this year is. I mean, nothing against this movie. It's just a near-perfect coming-of-age teen, you know, dramedy with some of the best youth performances of the last 15 years. Sonny Soljak, Nicole Smith, they better blow up. Lucas Hedges, he's going to have one hell of a 2019, let me tell you. Alongside, you know, playing fucking a version of Shia LaBeouf in a biopic. That's going to be crazy. Jonah Hill, he's established himself as a multi-talented motherfucker. He's an amazing actor, an amazing writer. He proved that with the 21 and 22 Jump Street movies. And now he gets to prove he's an amazing naturalistic director with mid-90s. His debut, which it only makes sense that her directorial debut is my favorite movie of this crazy fuck year. The cinematography is gorgeous. Every shot of this film is just perfect. The tone is perfect for a first feature, especially. And it was just super relatable, this movie. And just all the dialogue rung true, even if you don't like hearing some of the dialogue. Like, the best version of a time capsule movie you could think of. It wasn't, you know, dated in, like, the most pretentious and goofy way like a lot of Hollywood movies do. Like, it wasn't Ready Player One levels of nostalgia in this movie, even though it has one of the best soundtracks of the entire decade, you know, just loaded with 90s classics. I've gone on and on about this movie for months now. I couldn't talk about it for a couple months because I saw it early. And now that's all I couldn't really stop thinking about this year was mid-90s. I mean, I was blown away by Vox Lux, and I, you know, game night, rewatching that came close, but mid-90s really just, it was one of the most heartfelt and melancholy and just truthful films I've seen this year, and I think it's a job well done, and Jonah Hill is a genius.
Dustin, did you really make me watch an hour and 5 minute and 36 second long video just for me to hear you say Jonah Hill made the best movie of 2018? It was obviously Black Panther. It was obviously Black Klansman. It was obviously Crazy Rich Asians. It was obviously Avengers Infinity War. It was obviously Aquaman. You're gay for Jonah Hill, you biased piece of shit.
No, it's just, I would have absolutely admitted to you guys if mid-90s was not my favorite movie of the year. But, like I said, things came really close. Vox Lux and Game Night both came very, very, very close for me. And this year was just insanely underwhelming. Just let me point this out. I didn't give out a 10 out of 10 this year. I've given out a 10 out of 10 every year. Last year, it was very close for me. I, Tanya, was the only movie I gave a 10. And that was even close. So I don't know whether or not it's I'm getting older and movies are just, you know, underwhelming me more so than not, but like, Christ, I didn't try to be biased. Hopefully this year is going to be great, but it's probably not. I mean, we're getting movies from Tarantino and Wes Anderson and, you know, Shia LaBeouf is doing his biopic. So many fucking crazy movies coming out this year. Toy Story 4?
Toes and flows of angel hair and ice cream castles in the air. And
I can't stop picturing them dancing around Toni Collette's, like, severed head in, like, a group circle. That trailer is, like, legitimately horrifying.
I'm not a toy!
Especially after watching Hereditary. So, I don't know, I guess I'll see ya, unless I get murdered.
How much money you got? A lot. How many problems you got? A lot. How many people done doubted? A lot. Left you out to rot? A lot. How many predators you flaunt? A lot. How many lawyers you got? A lot.